Professor Abu Ghar has many publications and he has many awards on the level of national and international, and is also the vice director of this center. Professor Abu Ghar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, everybody. I know it is too late for you. I think most of you are exhausted. Today we will discuss the radiological perspective in hemodialysis. First, before discussion of the role of radiology in hemodialysis, first we have to discuss the role of radiology in diagnosis of renal failure. Before proceeding for hemodialysis, we need to know first if this patient is acute kidney injury or chronic kidney disease. Especially in those people presented for the first time with high serum creatinine, and of not unknown duration, and clinically we can classify them either it is acute kidney injury or chronic kidney disease. First, if the kidney is small size and radiological imaging such as ultrasound. I have to consider this is a chronic kidney disease. What's the challenge in the normal size kidney? Maybe acute, maybe chronic. But if kidney enlarged, I have to suggest that it's acute kidney injury. So the radiology have a critique in assessment of renal failure for hemodialysis. Suggests the cause of renal impairment. Also in cases of hemodialysis and long-term renal failure, it is usually associated with multiple complications. That can be detected at radiological imaging. Also, for the dialysis and before creation of the fistula, we have to do pre-dialysis assessment. Evaluation of the fistula for maturation. And the complication of fistula is one of the job of radiologists also. Also, placement of central lines nowadays done usually under ultrasound guidance and fluoroscopy. And in evaluation of renal impairment, we use this following imaging modalities. Ultrasound and QP is the basic modalities. Evaluation of the bladder and vesicle, literal reflux of the vesicle. With voiding the cystic erythrogram. MRI and CT used for evaluation of complications. Isotope scan to evaluate the kidney function. Ultrasound guided biopsy for evaluation for differentiation of acute from chronic kidney injury. And diagnose the cause of renal impairment. Ultrasound is the most initial diagnostic test. It is a non-invasive technique. Bedside. And nowadays considered as a part of clinical examination. It is free of risk of radiation and also no contrast material. As we said, if the kidney is small, so it is a long-standing and chronic kidney impairment should be considered. Also, ultrasound can detect correctable cause of renal failure such as hydronephrosis. as we can see here. This is a case of kidney ultrasound of the kidney. This is a grayscale ultrasound of the kidney. We can measure the kidney size. This is the length of the kidney. We measure it from hole to hole here. Normal size from 9 to 11 or up to 12. If less than 9 centimeters, I have to consider it a small size kidney. So this is the length of the kidney. This is the thickness of the renal parenchyma here. This is the renal capsule. And this is the renal sinus bed. And this is the parenchyma thickness here. Also, I have to evaluate the oxygenicity of the kidney. In comparison to the liver parenchyma oxygenicity. Usually it is less than the liver oxygenicity in normal. If it's similar to the liver or higher than the liver, I have to consider this is an increased echogenicity of the renal parenchyma. Case of chronic kidney. Chronic kidney disease. We can note here, this is the measurement of the kidney, it is 7 centimeters. Small size of the kidney. Echogenicity is higher than the liver. So it is directly echogenicity of the kidney. It is a chronic kidney disease. Other example of kidney affection in polycystic kidney disease here. The kidney replaced by cysts here. Not communicating with each other. And the kidney is involved. This is another cause of increased serum creatinine here. It's a case of hydromorphosis. The hydromorphosis with the kidneys is connected with each other here. The cysts here not communicating with each other. But the kidneys here is connected, it is in hydromorphosis. It's an example of voiding cystic retrogram. We fill the bladder with contrast. And the contrast is seen here refluxing into the kidneys. So it is a case of vesicular lateral reflux. One of the causes of renal failure, especially in pediatric. This is a bleeding X-ray and renal tube. You can see here, this is vascular calcification here. In case with long-term hemodialysis. The aorta here is calcified. This is calcified atheromas as the aorta. only change is in hyperparathyroidism, with bone erosion. What's about CT and MRI? CT and MRI is a cross-section and imaging. It is important to diagnose the complications. In patients who don't have hemodialysis, it can diagnose the tumors, lymph nodes, fibrosis, and calcification. Also, it's important, this can be done without contrast. Usually we need contrast. For natural evaluation and assessment.
No, no, no.
I think this is a renal artery stenosis. Or renal artery occlusion. But we should be careful with using gadolinium. Nowadays, you can do MR angiography without contrast.
So we can measure.
These are some examples of our CT and MRI. This is acquired cysts in patients on hemodialysis. This is an example of a small atrophic kidney and chronic kidney disease at CT. This is also CT without contrast. This is a case of polycystic kidney disease. With a
large
kidney. And multiple cysts are placing in the kidney. This is an MRI without contrast here. This is a chronic perinephritic kidney with dilated calyces, irregular control, and low signaling histiocalcium. The complications are from long-term hemodialysis. What? This is assessed complicated with an immune site. And this is after 6 months. This is tumor-large renal mass here. So it is a case of renal cell carcinoma in patient with hemodialysis. Another example also, a case of renal cell carcinoma in patient with hemodialysis here. Multiple cysts here. Here, and this is a solid enhancing MS here. Another example of complication in patients with renal impairment. It is a case of parathyroid adenoma. Non-contrast CT of the neck here. Where this is the thyroid. This is the thyroid. This is the trachea. This is the thyroid. And this is an edema posterior to the right thyroid too. It is about the right end. Also, this is a vascular calcification here in the cases. pulmonary CT. This is a density calcification along the coronary artery here. Also, this is density vascular calcification here. And the aorta and the iliac visit. Iliac visit. And the renal visits also. This is CT without contrast for calcification. Isotope scan or isotope renography. Usually used for measurement of GFR. For preoperative evaluation of upper extremity veins and arteries with complex ultrasound is useful adjunct to physical examination. Especially in obese patients, I can't examine the vessel clinically. I need to do a Doppler ultrasound for evaluation of arteries and veins of the arm and forearm. This is the anatomy here. Anatomy, this is the subclavian artery of the arm. This is the subclavian artery. Subclavian artery is going into clavial artery at the upper arm, and at the forearm, it is branched into ulnar artery. It is ulnar artery medially, and this is the radial artery laterally. This is the simple anatomy for the vessel to be evaluated at ultrasound. This is the venous system here. This is the cephalic, and this is the basalic. This is the cephalic vein here, and this is the basalic vein. They continue into the arm, and they go into the subclavian vein. This is the cephalic vein going into the subclavian vein here. What is about the arterial examination? We have first to evaluate the size of the artery before creation of the fistula. The diameter of the artery must be more than 2 millimeters. A significant increase the risk of arterial venous fistula failure usually occur if the diameter of the artery 1.6 or less. The diameter of the artery is measured at the site of creation of the fistula. Also, we have to report the size of the calcification. If there is a vascular calcification, it should be reported at the ulnar ultrasound. Evaluation of the resistive index is important of the artery. We have to do clenching of the hand for about 3 minutes. Then, after release of the hand, we measure the resistive index of the artery. If it is more than 4.7, I will not expect that it will be the creation of the fistula will not be suitable. Venous evaluation. The forearm veins most commonly used for arterial venous fistula creation. The spreading vein is usually used for creation of the fistula. We evaluate also the diameter, the depth of the vein, the force, collaterals, patency, and also compressibility of the veins. We use a tourniquet at the axilla or near the axilla. And then we measure the diameter of scapulic vein at different limits. It should be more than 2.5 millimeter with tourniquet. And without tourniquet, it should not less than 2 millimeter. So for creation of the fistula, I should fulfill this parameter first. If the diameter, the arterial diameter should be more than 1.6 millimeter, the venous diameter should be more than 2 millimeter without tourniquet, and 2.5 millimeter if I use tourniquet. Third, the arterial resistive index should be less than 0.7. First, I have to use grayscale ultrasound. I measure the inner lumen here, a gray, and I comment if there is a calcification. Then I use color. This is normal color flow with homogeneous flow inside the vessel. This is a spectral wave. This is the waves from the artery. It is a normal waves from the artery. From the peripheral arteries, it is a triphasic wave here. Again, this is the peak here. This is the second peak, this is the second wave, and this is the third. This is triphasic flow here. This is a normal brachial artery flow. This is abnormal radial artery. And you can note this is a regular flow here, suggesting and partial occlusion in the artery here due to atheromatous calcification, atheromatous index here with narrowing of the artery. So this artery is not suitable for creation of the fistula. For the venous evaluation, this is where we have to assess the compressibility, the ergogenicity of the lumen, the irregularity, and the diameter of the vein. This is a normal xeric vein here. You can